Welcome to TheoTrade. This is Don Kaufman. Here we are doing the weekend update on September 22nd, 2017. The markets just closed a few moments ago. I'm going to do a brief update on some of the action or lack thereof of this previous week. And of course, look forward to the coming trading days and ultimately what we see inside of markets right now. First, if you take a look at the S&Ps, here we have the spiders. For the most part, what did this week hold? Absolutely nothing regarding specifically the S&P. Vastly different story, though, throughout the rest of the marketplace. In fact, I'm going to start by doing a quick review inside of the SPX, okay? And we're going to go ahead and we're going to bring up our expected moves. Now, what these expected moves ultimately are, okay, it's for the most part where the week originated, where it ended, and what the option markets, okay, depicted risk to be. So to kind of give you a quick lowdown over here, this is exactly where the week started. The irony is where we started is precisely where we finished, 2,500 in terms of the S&Ps, okay? We had a very, very mild rally, came right back down again, smack on 2,500. This next week, a very, very similar expected move. What is that? We're looking at about $21, either higher or lower. The volatility for the coming week is extraordinarily low. I mean, here we are at $20 and basically 56 cents to cash close here on Friday. So again, volatility being 7%. That's like the VIX, which of course is $9.50. All right, this is the VIX for the next 7 days. It's at 7%. Again, some of the lowest volatility recorded, neither here nor there. But throughout the course of this week, sure, the S&Ps did absolutely nothing. There were all kind of risks that were thrown in the face of the markets. What are some of the risks this week? Obviously, we saw Janet Yellen, which we're going to talk about here momentarily, a little bit of quantitative easing discussion there and the unwinding of the portfolio. Other risks include, of course, geopolitical, North Korea, the UN. I mean, I can go on and on with different risks. The impact to the market, negligible. However, the bigger risk this week seemed to be coming from something like, well, Apple. So let's go over to the Nasdaq. And again, it's been like a tale of completely different markets. So the Nasdaq is definitely in a downtrend. And when you start looking at the Nasdaq, okay, versus the expected move, this is fairly extraordinary. I mean, I've seen some fairly crazy things happen in markets, but if you take a look at this particular week that we just passed through, the expected move on the NASDAQ, it actually closed on the button to the lower end of the expected move. Literally, the edge of the expected move was 144.32. On the button, we close to the edge of the expected move. So, as I said, kind of a tale of two different markets, the SPX finished the week unchanged. The NASDAQ finishes the week at the edge again and the lower edge of the expected move. Oh, but wait, there's something more. A little bit crazy over here. If you take a look at the IWM, the Russell, it's the exact opposite. Now, we have not been tracking expected moves per se on the Russell, but I have an auto expected move script. And the interesting aspect of the auto expected move script here is that it depicts that we closed outside of the upper band. So here we have the S&Ps doing nothing, okay? The NASDAQ falling, but we're seeing a rotation of capital. And this is kind of like this wild game. I've been calling it the shell game, but it really amounts to like this wild game of chicken between the NASDAQ, okay, the IWM, which is of course the Russell, and last but definitely not least, the S&Ps. And the S&Ps are caught relatively in the middle over here. So, you know, what's really driving, by the way, the Russell has a lot to do with some of the financials out there. If you take a look at the financials, they're going to look a lot like the Russell. Again, the financials themselves closing towards and outside the upper cusp of their expected move this week, a wild move to the upside inside of financials. Now, let's get to some of the drivers. If you are looking specifically at the NASDAQ, I think you have to single out, of course, Apple. So Apple had a rough week. It is in a fairly ugly downtrend. Now, for those of you that do tune into the TheoTrade chat on a day-to-day basis, we've been highly critical, even talking about Apple cresting down under this 150. We pegged the fact that if it broke 154, things were going to get ugly, and they did. It actually gapped a little bit lower. Today's trade, we had a nice intraday scalp. Neither here nor there. If you take a look at Google, not really under any heavy pressure, but Google to me looks like the next foot ultimately to drop inside of the Nasdaq. However, before we get too far ahead, we need to backtrack and we need to talk a little bit about the S&Ps, okay? Which for the most part, the S&Ps are caught in the middle of what's going on. Again, if you looked at a comparison chart, which we could bring up here momentarily, you have the Russell exploding higher, you have the Nasdaq coming down, and the S&Ps are literally caught right smack in the middle. In fact, I can even bring this up. I've got a study for that, a style for that. If I come here under style, and this is a style that I happen to build, it's a comparison of the Qs, the spiders, and the IWM. And on a comparison basis, right, I'll throw in like, here's a 6 month, again, a 6 month comparison. And you can see just this. This is the NASDAQ, okay? Down below over here, we actually have the IWM, and right smack in the middle happens to be another than, this is the spiders. So taken even on a shorter term basis, if we want to look at this on a shorter term basis over the last 3 months, okay, they're ultimately converging upon one another once again. On a longer term horizon though, this is still a little bit intimidating. On a longer term horizon, right up here is the NASDAQ. Yeah, it's a long way down. All right. The one thing that resonates with me the most this week and really in just recent trading months, okay, we have seen fairly extraordinary events thrown at the marketplace, and the marketplace is shrugging everything off. I think it was put best by one of our traders and instructors here at TheoTrade, Tony Rago. He trades a lot of NASDAQ futures, and that's predominantly what he does on a day-to-day basis. I mean, I have to agree with this statement 100%, but Tony had mentioned the entire market is just one large powder keg at this point, which is pretty negative. I mean, kind of got to get it through your head over here. Forget about, for a second, what you might think about direction of the markets. We're sitting in a situation where every asset class that you look at, okay, is incredibly full. I mean, look at it like a 3 year, even in the bond market. And again, I would have to contract adjust this, so bear with me for a second, okay? You might want to look at something like bonds, okay, which even over the last 10 years have had an incredible rally. You can go look at the S&Ps. It's over the last 10 years on a monthly, okay? IWM, you name, for the most part, a product out there, okay? And we're talking about extremes. That is not necessarily my larger concern, because at this point, I think everybody could probably make an argument whether you're going to go higher or lower, okay? The fact of the matter is, the powder keg that we're sitting on right now is volatility. It's just, and again, most people would look at the VIX. The VIX does not function, okay, like it used to. Now, we can argue again all the different reasons beyond that. It's neither here nor there. The VIX is not functioning at this point. Why? There's a suppression of all volatility. Why is there a suppression of volatility? Because you have hundreds of billions of dollars seeking any returns possible, okay? And this actually goes into what the FOMC has been discussing lately, which has been a lot about, you know, removing their balance sheet, the $4.5 trillion that's sitting on the Fed balance sheet. And I'll relate that back to like the TNX. But flooding the markets with capital, and again, the Fed, did they flood necessarily the equity markets? No, they flooded the bond market. But by flooding the bond market with capital, they force interest rates ultimately down. So at this point in time, what they're gonna do is the Fed is sitting out there, okay, with pretty hefty balance sheet, okay? And their balance sheet happens to be, and I'll just draw it up here, it's about 4.5 trillion is sitting on their balance sheet. And again, this happens to be the interest rates associated in the TNX with the 10-year. And it's sitting right about 2.2 2%. Now, the assumption is as soon as the Fed starts to unwind this, that it's going to impact these interest rates and the interest rates are going to take off to the upside. Frankly speaking, I disagree with that. And I'll tell you exactly why I disagree with that. The moment, first of all, they start to unwind this balance sheet, they're not actually going to sell any bonds. Okay. The Fed does not have to go out, and this is a big misconception, the Fed does not have to go out and start selling bonds to get out of its $4.5 trillion. All they have to do is let some of the bonds that they're in, or some of the notes they're in, or some of the T-bills they're in, they let them go to maturity. So the contract matures, and what do? They just don't put anything else out there. They're, okay, we're not going to buy anymore. All right, and eventually that'll work itself through. But that's going to contract liquidity from the marketplace. And the marketplace is going to first contract liquidity, in my belief, is going to be the broader markets. Now, this is not, I'm not here to give you an argument to be bullish and or bearish, okay? The volatility has been suppressed for so long, people don't even like know what that looks like. Whatever you might believe about direction of the market is neither here nor there. At this point in time, if you're not hedging yourself to the downside, or have some type of a bet and saying like, hey, there's a chance that we could sell off, what, 5, 10, 15%. I think at this point in time, you're kind of fooling yourself, because you can look back over the last 3 years and you can see, you know, glimmers of volatility appearing in here. But for the most part, a true and definitive pullback, it has been, okay, to say long overdue would be an understatement. But there is absolutely, there's no timing any type of pullback in here. And at this point, I think we've passed the idea of like, oh, the market needs to correct, okay? We're so far past that it's ridiculous. Even when you want to talk about, you know, like, all right, Brexit or the election and some volatility. The last time we saw any real sustained volatility, you got to go back to the beginning of 2016 when the S&Ps tanked down to about 1800, okay? So neither here nor there. We've had a straight shot from 1800 ultimately to 2500. Okay. So I think we've really surpassed the idea like, all right, we need to correct over here. Any volatility that hits the market at this point, the point I want to make you very, very aware of, if volatility hits the market at this point, it's going to be violence in terms of trading. It's the only way that this ultimately cracks and breaks. We're no longer going to drift softly into the night. You're going to wake up and the S&Ps will be down 50. Speaking of the S&Ps down 50, that sounds like a lot. But the last time the market really made any true and violent moves, okay, you got to go all the way back to when the S&Ps were in the 2000 level. And 50 points meant a lot when you're at 2000. Yeah, well, 50 points doesn't mean that much on a percentage basis now when you're at 2,500. You know, why don't people have in their minds the idea, for example, okay, of, hey, statistically significant doesn't even begin till a 3% move occurs. That's on a one-day basis, a 3% move on a one-day basis. And you start looking at the S&Ps and they're literally sitting at 2,500. Again, this is not an argument to be bullish and or bearish. It's to recognize the substantial risk, okay, that's out there. And when I look at this and I think, all right, so, you know, you got a 25-point move, it's about 1%. So until we start seeing moves, in essence, of 75 points in a day on the S&P futures, we're not even actually getting that train out of the station over there in terms of volatility. Forget about the VIX. Let's assume that the VIX is a dead product over here. Start changing things into percentage terms. These S&P futures rocking at 75 points. Then, and only then, we start seeing some volatility. The last real volatility we saw, what, the night of the election? The night of the election, we went down 5%. We went limit down. We locked up. We rallied out of it. Okay, great. But at this point in time, you have to take this seriously. Now, a lot of people are going to run and they're like, okay, so what can I do? What can I do? And that's exactly what I'm talking about. We're doing a class this weekend. It's one of the reasons I'm mentioning this. And it's not here to, you know, let's pitch you for a class. If you're a member of TheoTrade, you have got to listen to this stuff. You have got to pay attention and you have got to hedge yourself, whether it's a 401k or an IRA, okay? If you don't have a risk mitigation tactic at this point, you know, you're the person sitting on top of the powder keg, because don't tell me the trading firms are gonna have a blast when the volatility hits. Who ends up holding the bag of risk. It's mom and pop that are doing a covered call out there. It's your 401k. You know, the trading firm's just going to sell the futures into an oblivion. They're already long all kinds of volatility. So again, the argument is you have got to learn how to mitigate your risk. And some people are going to go, well, I'm going to go out and I'm going to buy me something like VXX. You can go out and buy the VXX. You know what? Forget about the last 3 years. Check this out. Here's a year to date. You want to buy volatility in the VXX? Year to date, the product's already down 56%. Right? That's buying volatility over there. By the way, if you look at it over the last year, this is a 1 year, it's down 70% year to date. How is that even fair? So you can't just go out and buy the VXX. Somebody goes, well, I could buy the UVXY. Yeah, the UVXY. It's down 92% over the last year. Can't make that up, right? That's a 1 year chart. If you bought volatility over the last 3 years, hey, look, this is real. It went from $28,000 to $22. You lost 99.81%. You gotta get smarter than that. The UVXY, it's a dead product. You cannot, you know, people are going to go out and they're like, well, I'll buy puts in the SPX. Guess what? You want to buy puts in the SPX? Check this out. Go out about like, 30 days, open up all the strikes. And if you look at the implied volatility inside the SPX, okay, everything's already skewed against you. The further you go out of the money, the puts are costing more and more money. Look at this. They're up to like 16% volatility because everybody sees the risk. Okay. You've got to, again, you got to get a little bit smarter than that. So we put together a strategy, and I'm going to go all the way out to January, all right? Go all the way out to January. We put together a strategy called a risk twist spread. And what it ultimately does is mitigates a very, very large degree of your risk, okay, by twisting the volatility skew ultimately in your favor. Now, I just built a trade. It's a 1 by 3 by 1. And if you take a look at the trade, okay, I know people, the first thing they look at is the risk. They're like, oh my gosh, you could lose money. Yeah, there's an easy way to mitigate that risk. You can put this trade on and not have this valley of death risk in there, okay? This is more what the risk graph will look like. Now, I'm not telling you again that the market's going to tank, but I can tell you this. For a $100 debit, for the entire quarter, this trade is good through January, for the entire quarter, for $100 debit, okay, you've got a risk mitigation tactic. You're like, well, how much money can this thing ultimately make, all right? Well, let's actually put a slice, and let's say that the market sold off by 10%, okay? Let's just take the market, let's sell it off by a full 10%. In fact, I'm gonna change this right here to percentage. I'm gonna back the market down by 10%. Now you're thinking, all right, it's gonna make 633%. Yeah, this is one unit, one contract, 1 by 3 by 1, but that doesn't include the fact that volatility is very likely to go up, okay? Let's move volatility up a full 10 points. All of a sudden, okay, little one lot over here for $100, the P&L should be right around $1,200, $1,300. This is what I'm gonna teach people to mitigate risk with, okay? I can't stress this stuff enough. We call it a risk twist spread. And the reason it's a 1 by 3 by 1 is to offset the volatility skew, okay? If you were a member of TheoTrade, I am doing the class tomorrow. It's Saturday, okay? This Saturday, yes, it is September 23rd. It starts 7 a.m. Pacific, 10 a.m. Eastern time. So if you're a member and you can't make it, fine, listen to the archive. If you are not a member, there's not too many classes I feel this strongly about, you know, that I'm, you know, on here going off. Go to theotrade.com/twist. What the class consists of, we call the class the next big short risk twist spreads class. Again, Saturday the 23rd, 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. The entire thing is archived. It's $197. If you're not a member, yeah, you got to sign up for a class, okay? But the class will teach you every nuance. And I'm begging you, please, don't try to do the trade without having gone through the class. The class is about specific criteria. It tells you how many contracts to use to hedge your portfolio. It tells you how many contracts to use, whether you have a $2,000 account, okay, or a $5 million account. It'll actually allocate the number of contracts. It'll tell you how to get out of the trade and how you can actually risk one to be able to make 10 in there. All the entry exit criteria is in there. In addition to it, We have options 101, options 201, options 301, options 401, and a guide to getting short and collecting income. That's for people that want to be short the marketplace and sell premium against it. Okay. I can't stress enough the importance of the class. And this is a course that, again, I've been doing these strategies now for years. They only have to pay off one time. And you're like, well, I'm going to do this class just to learn like a strategy. Yeah. And that one strategy pays off one time in your career of trading. Okay. You think it wasn't worth 3 hours of your time and $197. You have got to listen to this stuff. It's literally, and again, Tony Rago put this perfectly, the market's a powder keg, ready to go over here. Could we grind a little bit higher? Absolutely. But at the same time, hedge your risk. Again, it's theotrade.com/twist, theotrade.com/twist. With that, I will see many of you, of course, at the class, which kicks off on Saturday. If you're listening to this on Saturday and you're not, you know, going to the class, it's fine. The class is archived. Every second of that course is archived out there. So by all means, check it out, theotrade.com/twist. Many of you that are members, just join us right in the TheoTrade chat room at 7 a.m. Pacific time. Thanks, everybody. Have a wonderful weekend. Bye-bye.